Welcome to the Wildcast. Back again. We are back for another episode of the Wildcast. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back again with the conference finals of the NBA. The NBA conference finals are here. It is the Mavericks and the Timberwolves against the Celtics and the Pacers. And actually, the Pacers have already been swept by the Boston Celtics. So we're just waiting to see who joins the Celtics in the NBA finals. And for today, we're just going to talk about what I think of the playoffs and what I think of the conference finals, what I think of these four teams, or what I thought of the Pacers, I should say, and how I think the rest of the very short season we have left is going to play out. As of always, before we get into anything, make sure to like on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and if you're on YouTube, subscribe, share the podcast around, whatever you want to do. We're going to try to get back up on TikTok shortly. Who knows? We'll get there. But for today, again, the conference finals. Now, we can just talk about a little bit about how each team got here, right? So we can start with the Boston Celtics, who are the heavy favorite, who have been the heavy favorite almost this entire playoffs, I think. Their road to the finals right now has been something that has been highly criticized, right? Of course, in the first round, you go up against the Miami Heat team that doesn't have Jimmy Butler, doesn't have Terry Rozier. And when you don't have two of your starters, you're going to struggle a lot. And one of those starters being your best player on your team. Now, obviously, the Heat did beat the Celtics last year. And honestly, they took a game from them this year again, which the Pacers couldn't do. And the Cavs, well, the Cavs did. Sorry, my apologies. Which the Pacers couldn't do. Now, the Miami Heat obviously are a team that shows up in the playoffs. And, well, If they were healthy, who knows what would have happened. Maybe they still would have lost. This Celtics team looks very good, and they look very confident. They look very comfortable in these playoff games. But I don't know. Again, it's not really something you can decide on based on how many injuries there were with this Miami Heat team. It's not just how many there were. It's how important they were and how impactful these injuries actually were. You couldn't have one of your best scorers in Terry Rozier, and you couldn't have your best player in Jimmy Butler. Now, in the second round when they played the Cavs, it was a lot of the same story, right? I believe in the closeout game of the series, Game 5, it was Jared Allen was out, DG was out, Donovan Mitchell was out. They had all these top guys, all these starters, and Donovan Mitchell, their star player, all out due to injury yet again. And I can't say or not whether the Cavs would have made it more of a series. I think they still would have lost the series overall. The Cavs didn't look as good as the Boston Celtics that series. But again, it's something that you can't really give an opinion on because at the end of the day, we don't know what would have happened. We don't know what could have happened this season if everybody played, if everybody was fully healthy. We just don't know what could have happened. We don't know what would have happened. And obviously, the Pacers just got swept because in the last two games of the series, Tyrese Haliburton wasn't playing, their best player. Now, obviously, Andrew Nembhard stepped up big time, and Pascal Siakam, the player that I've been most impressed by in this postseason has been Pascal Siakam. I've been so impressed watching him play. He seems so confident, and he seems so aggressive, and he's in this attack mode all the time. And he just looks like a very confident player and very comfortable player. And that says something, right? Because if you're not confident, if you're not comfortable, you're not going to do well because a lot of offense comes from confidence and having confidence in yourself. But again, it's the Boston Celtics beat a injured team in every single series so far. So if they go into the finals and they do end up playing the Mavericks, probably, who are up 3-1 in the series as of right now. If they do end up playing the Mavericks, then it'll be their first almost fully healthy team, we can say in quotes, because this whole postseason, Luka's been playing with injuries. How many reports came out that he had like three injuries that he's just playing through? So in all actuality, this whole postseason for the Boston Celtics, in my eyes, has been just playing some games, right? It's not really actual competitive basketball for them so much, but it is because all these games, all these series have been close. Like all four games of the Pacers series, well, I guess three. Game three wasn't very close, but games 1, 2, and 4 were all nail biters against the Pacers. against the Heat, there was a lot of nail biters too. You had the one game that the Heat actually stole from them. But in all actuality, it's been a pretty easy run for the Boston Celtics. So when the finals come, it'll actually hopefully be their first fully healthy team that they're coming up against. And that'll probably be their first true test, and it'll be the most important true test because it will be the NBA Finals. The Pacers were much of the same story, right? You come up against the Bucks without Giannis, and then Dame went down after Game 2. Chris Middleton went down for a game. You had Bobby Portis ejected in Game 3, I believe. It was more of the same of just the Pacers weren't playing a fully healthy team. And honestly, here's the thing. With every single NBA championship run, there comes a little bit of luck, right? You don't win a NBA championship without luck. I've seen hundreds of thousands of NBA players go on podcasts and state that you can't win a championship if you don't get a little bit of lucky. Everything has to fall into place in the correct way. So, obviously, injuries are going to play a factor, right? Because if the Raptors in 2019 don't have KD and Klay all get injured, then they probably don't win a championship. But the pieces fell into place for them to win it. Obviously, in the bubble, 2020, if we don't go into the bubble, do the Lakers win the championship? Pieces fell into place. Everything's going to fall into place perfectly for you to win a championship. And I just don't know if I want to see it to this extent. Like, the Pacers made the conference finals run. Good for them. They were a great team. This isn't to, like, put the Pacers down at all, because at the end of the day, they were a very good team. Andrew Nembhard stepped up big time. Aaron Nesmith has played some of the best basketball I've seen him play. And it was just kind of upsetting to see them go up against a Bucks team without Giannis and Dame and Chris Middleton and Bobby Portis, and then go up against a Knicks team where, granted, Jalen Brunson didn't break his hand until Game 7, but he still broke his hand in Game 7. You had Josh Hart with that ab injury. Julius Randle hasn't played for the entire playoffs. You had a bunch of OG Anunoby, too, who went out early in Game 7, who tried to play and just got pulled out right away. It's just frustrating to see, because you want to see these teams at their best, because I would have loved to see a Knicks run. I would have loved to see the Knicks make this run. I feel like they could have put up a better fight against the Boston Celtics than the Pacers could have, and I truly believe that. But again, the Pacers got the chance because the pieces fell in place for them. They blew their chance against the Celtics, but again, they're the ones that got injured that time. Their luck finally ran out, and the Celtics' luck keeps on going. Ironic, because they're the Celtics, and they got, maybe they've been rubbing a lot of four-leaf clovers, who knows. But their luck continues to go. But at the end of the day, again, this finals is going to be the biggest test in the Boston Celtics, right? Is it going to be the biggest test for the Boston Celtics of this playoffs? Because it's going to be the first fully healthy team they come up against. Whether the Timberwolves make this 3-0 comeback, or the Mavericks actually push through and close out the series, which they have Kyrie Irving, they have Luka Doncic, they have probably the best backcourt in the league. I'll say that lightly, because I haven't really decided or looked at backcourts. I mean, we might do an episode of just ranking backcourts. That might be a fun episode. If you want to see that, let me know in the comments. But if one of those teams make it to the finals against Celtics, it's going to be their first fully healthy team to play against. So it will be a true test. But the thing that worries me the most, if I'm a Boston Celtics fan, which I am definitely not, is you have played against all these beat-up teams, and the series have been, well, not the series, because you won 4-1, 4-1, 4-0, but the games in the series, you went overtime against the Pacers in Game 1. It was a close game in Game 2, and then Game 4 two nights ago, Andrew Nembhard almost saved them from a Game 4 elimination. Andrew Nembhard had like 32, and then he had 28 the next night. He was stepping up without Tyrese Halliburton. So if you're playing these injured teams, and the Heat, they took a game without Jimmy Butler and Terry Rozier. You lost a game in the playoffs to the Heat with Bam and Tyler Hero. That was their players. Nikola Jovic was playing well. Jaime Jaquez and Kevin Love. But you lost games to these teams. So if I'm a Celtics fan, again, which I am definitely not, you have to be worried a little bit, because you're not coming up against fully healthy teams, and these are still nail-biter games. Not the, the series aren't nail-biters, and at the end of the day, you almost swept through your entire way through the playoffs so far. But these games are close. It's always, it's a situation where it could easily have been a six-game series against the Pacers. It could have easily been a seven-game series against the Cavs if one or two shots went the right way. So when you come up against the Mavericks and you have Kyrie Irving, who's one of the best closers I've seen in my life, and you have Luka Doncic, who is an automatic 30-point triple-double, and especially when it comes finals time, I don't even want to see the level that those two step up to. We know what Kyrie can do. I don't know what Luka can do when it comes finals time. This man is probably going to go crazy. He's going to average 40-point triple-double probably in the finals. But you have to close out games against those two. And it's been rough watching the Celtics close these games late down the stretch because they, although they can, it just turns down to, it just turns out to Derek White and Jrue Holiday saving the day every single game. Now, Jason and Jalen obviously put up the shots, and Jalen hit that big shot in game one against the Pacers. But down the stretch, Derek White and Jrue Holiday come up with the big plays to save the game. Now, who knows what's going to happen? I can't predict the future. I don't know everything. But if I'm a Celtics fan, I would be a little bit nervous coming up against the Dallas Mavericks. But speaking of the Dallas Mavericks, they have one of the most impressive runs to the finals that I've, in my opinion, of this playoffs. They went up against the Clippers in round one. Obviously, they had injury problems yet again. The Clippers curse will not end ever. It will not end ever. If these guys can stay healthy for at least one season, that's all I want to see. That's all the entire NBA world wants to see, is one healthy season of this Clippers team. But who? It'll never come. It'll never come. And although it was another injury-riddled team, the Mavericks played their butts off. This was an impressive series from the Mavericks. They closed this out, no ifs, ands, or buts. They knew what they were doing. They came in and they finished the job. Kyrie Irving played Kyrie Irving in playoffs time is a different animal. This man just, he steps it up another notch that nobody ever expects. Nobody ever sees it coming, but he does it every time. Luka, obviously, playing through the injuries, he looked a step slow in the first round, but I think it was just because he was taking a step back a little bit. He was trying to conserve some energy. He knew he was injured and playing through some injuries. So he kind of let Kyrie run the show because he's confident in Kyrie. The fan base is confident in Kyrie. And PJ Washington is playing like one of the best role players in the playoffs. Second round, they came against the number one seeded OKC Thunder. And again, extremely impressive. This Thunder team looked amazing coming into the playoffs. They swept the Pelicans and they came in with a lot of confidence. But at the end of the day, it was a young team who didn't have a lot of playoff experience, and the Mavericks had Kyrie Irving, again, who dominated this team. And the reoccurring theme that I've been seeing with the Mavericks, and it's why I've been liking them this playoff so far, is the unstoppable guard play. There's very few teams, and the Celtics are one of them, by the way, there is very few teams, maybe one or two, who can stop a backcourt of Luka and Kyrie. Now, I'm not saying backcourts win championships, but a lot, you have to have a good backcourt to win a championship. And they have probably the best one in the league. So if you're stopping Kyrie, you need another small to put on Luka. If you're stopping Luka, you need another small to put on Kyrie. Because if you put a big on them, they're blowing right past them. If you put a good defending big on them, you're blowing right past them. And you can't like paint sit like the Timberwolves have been doing with Rudy Gobert, because Luka and Kyrie both excel in the mid-range. Kyrie excels at finishing at the rim. He's one of the best finishers at the rim of the league. And if you get that perimeter switch, like we saw with the Luka game winner in game three, it's an easy bucket. So these two combined, one of them is going to have a mismatch at every single possession. So it's just scary. If you help off, they have shooters around them. They have DJJ, who's been, I've been so impressed with Derrick Jones Jr. This is the best basketball of his career without a single doubt. He's playing so well. PJ Washington is playing amazing. Jaden Hardy, don't even get me started. Don't even get me started on Jaden Hardy, because in that draft class, I'm not saying I'm disappointed in Max Christie. I love Max Christie. Sorry to go on a Lakers tangent, but I have to mention Lakers in every episode. When this draft happened and we drafted Max Christie, I tweeted out before our pick, before we picked Max, I said, if the Lakers pass up on Jaden Hardy, I will be irate. And we passed up on Jaden Hardy. Now, I'm not disappointed in Max Christie, but I'm watching Jaden Hardy play, and I'm like, man, he could have been ours. He could have been a Laker. Jaden Hardy is playing very well. He's playing. He's hitting big shots. He hit a huge one last night in the fourth quarter. He drilled a three, a big three. Josh Green has been playing very good too. Maxi Kleba came back from injury. Daniel Gafford, of course, has been playing fantastic. D-Live obviously was sitting last night out with an injury. But hopefully he comes back, because the Derek Lively-Daniel Gafford center tandem has been very fun to watch, because both centers are very complementary and they both fit perfectly with Luka and Kyrie and what they want to do. They want two rim-running centers who are going to dunk the ball and catch lobs. And that's what those two excel at, right? They play defense, they get rebounds, they push the ball, and then they catch lobs from Luka and Kyrie. Daniel Gafford obviously has one of the almost set that record for most field goals made without a miss in that one stretch when he had, he was 6 for 6 last night as well. So he's efficient. He's a very efficient center. And these two fit very well with Luka and Kyrie. So hopefully D-Live can come back when they make the finals run. And then, obviously, they're up 3-1 on the Minnesota Timberwolves currently. They need to close out the series still. But this series have been very eye-opening, right? Because, obviously, the Timberwolves just beat up on the defending champs in 7 games. And I don't know whether it's fatigue or the Timberwolves were only built to beat the Denver Nuggets, because they do have the Denver Nuggets old GM on their team now. I don't know if their one goal was to beat Denver and then we'll worry about every other team later, or if they're just tired out because they played against the Suns. They had to beat the Suns in a very hard and fought series. And then they had to beat the Denver Nuggets, the defending champions, who are unstoppable almost. But obviously they did get stopped by a team that was built to beat them specifically. It's probably a mix of those two. I don't know what's happening with Minnesota, in my personal opinion. I don't know what's happening with them. They have the most impressive path to the conference finals, in my opinion. They beat up on a Phoenix Suns team who we all thought was going to go far. This team was built to win a championship. Devin Booker, Bradley Beal, Kevin Durant, Yusuf Nurkic, Grayson Allen was having the best season of his career. And the Timberwolves made them look easy. The Denver Nuggets were the defending champs. Jokic, another MVP. Jamal Murray was playing on top of the world against the Lakers. Michael Porter Jr. couldn't miss against the Lakers. And the Timberwolves shut that entire team down. And now they come up against the Dallas Mavericks and Luka and Kyrie, and they suddenly look like a team that is defeated. They already look defeated. And I said this at the beginning of the series to my buddy, that although I would like to see the Timberwolves make the finals run, because I like Anthony Edwards, I like Karl-Anthony Towns, I'm an ex-Minnesota secondary fan because D'Lo, who used to be on there, and whatever team D'Lo's on, is my second favorite team. So I would love to see them in the finals, but I don't know what's happening. I really don't know. And the Dallas Mavericks have some of the best guard play. I said this at the beginning of the series. Dallas has too much guard play, and the Timberwolves cannot stop them, because the Timberwolves are built to stop big man teams. They are built to beat big man teams. Now their guard play stoppage is highly It's highly reliant on Jaden McDaniels and Nikhil Alexander-Walker and Mike Conley playing great defense on these guys. Now, Anthony Edwards obviously played fantastic defense in the Suns series, and he might be tired still. He played fantastic defense in the Nuggets series, and again, he might be tired because he has been very underwhelming compared to the other two series. He's been very underwhelming this series. He's had high points scored, but the efficiency is not there anymore. I don't know what it is. The Timberwolves kind of just, I feel like they just burnt out. And next season, I feel like they're going to retool a little bit. They're going to get some more pieces to come off their bench. Probably look for some more scoring options is what I would suggest. But I think next season, they're going to come with a different mindset. They're going to be ready. And if they make the conference finals again, come that time, they will be ready for it. They will not burn out again, hopefully. We will see. But again, the Dallas Mavericks, if they win this series and close it out, they will be playing the Boston Celtics in the NBA Finals. Now, this is one of the toughest predictions that I had to make, because I didn't expect the Dallas Mavericks to be here. And heck, I don't know if I really expected the Boston Celtics to be here, because I can never trust Tatum and Brown in the playoffs. I've never been able to. They've always let everybody down. They've always let their own fans down. They've always crashed out at some point. But this is one of the tougher predictions because I haven't given it much thought. There was no part in my mind that I actually think the Mavericks could make a finals run. And honestly, I'm happy for it. I love Kyrie. I love anybody who's a Kobe disciple, a Kobe Bryant disciple. And Kyrie is a Kobe disciple, right? He has the mentality of he doesn't care. He's just going to play his game and work in his game and always get better. At the end of the day, I don't know how much you can do to stop the guard play of Luka and Kyrie. Now, I understand that Jrue Holiday and Derrick White are probably the best defensive backcourt in the league. And I'm going to pause right here because when I was watching game three, Doris Burke was doing the commentary, right? And for some reason, I don't know why, maybe she actually believes this, but she said Boston obviously has Jrue and Derrick White, the best guys to do it in the league. Now, obviously there she's referring to them being, in her opinion, I guess, the best backcourt in the NBA. I don't think that's true whatsoever. They may be the best defensive backcourt in the league. That probably you can make an argument for, the best defensive backcourt in the league. But even if you are the best defensive backcourt in the league, you're not stopping, quote-unquote. You may slow down a little bit, but you're not stopping a Luka and Kyrie backcourt. And these two dudes can facilitate for everybody on their team. Everybody else on their team knows what their spots are, where their spots need to be. And if these dudes aren't scoring, you're going to have PJ Washington sitting in that left corner. You're going to have Daniel Gafford or Derek Lively setting screens and getting to the dunker spot. And then you're going to have Derek Jones Jr. or Josh Green or Jaden Hardy or whoever's closing out the game or playing the best in the other corner, getting ready to shoot threes. Once these two dudes have decided that a double team gets thrown at them or they want to take the shot or they just want to pass because it's the right play anyways. These two dudes, I trust more. I trust Luka and Kyrie more than anybody on the Boston Celtics. The Boston Celtics have the overall better team. They do. But there comes a point where you're going to have to sub in Peyton Pritchard. You're going to have to sub in Sam Hauser. And somebody is going to have to guard Luka and Kyrie. I don't know how many people on your team can do that. So, again, this may be bias talking. This may be bias. But I think Dallas have this one in six. I think they do. They don't have the better team. The Boston Celtics obviously have the better team. But I'm looking at who I trust more. I trust Luka and Kyrie the most out of these two teams. And I'm looking at role players. I love how PJ Washington's been playing. I love how PJ Washington's been playing. Now, you can consider Jrue and Derek White role players, I guess, quote unquote. I've been saying all season that Derek White is the best role player in the NBA, which that is probably true. Derek White is probably the best role player in the NBA. So, but then you get deeper in the rotation. And the Celtics, you have Peyton Pritchard, Sam Hauser, who is Wisconsin's own. As much as I'd love to defend him, he is Wisconsin's own, but he doesn't match up to much on the Dallas Mavericks side. You have Al Horford, the glue guy, who's been playing fantastic, but as he is a starter right now, you're seeing Xavier Tillman get more minutes, and him as a role player is a bit shaky. You have all these other role players that are kind of questionable on the Boston Celtics side. But then you go back over to the Mavericks, who have Lively or Gafford, whoever's starting and coming off the bench at the time. You have Maxi Kleba, who can play small ball five and get you some threes. You have Jaden Hardy. You have Josh Green. You have Derek Jones Jr. These guys are playing fantastic basketball. They're playing very well. It's very impressive to watch. So I like the role players of the Dallas Mavericks better as well. Coaching. Jason Kidd's been game planning like I've never seen before. If Jason Kidd did this while he was the Nets coach, while he was the Bucks coach, he might still be on those teams. But Jason Kidd's a different coach. I don't know what got into him. I don't know if he's just he's been a coach for so long that he's finally figuring it out. But he's making adjustments. He's calling the right plays. He's making the right calls. He's coaching extremely well. And Joe Mazzulla's never been known as a good coach. He's always been a guy that makes some risky or questionable decisions down the stretch when it matters, who maybe holds on to his timeouts when he shouldn't and doesn't really understand the right matchups that he should go with. But his team is easy to coach. So, I mean, I would like Jason Kidd better. And so in my eyes, those are my three biggest things. Now, obviously, there is the whole factor of Jason Tatum. Honestly, if you look at best player in the series, it is probably Luka. I'd probably take Luka over Jason Tatum, personally. But the Celtics have objectively the better team. And if Kristaps Porzingis does come back from injury, that's going to be a problem that the Mavericks are going to have to worry about. Because there's another guy to stretch the floor. It's a 7-3 guy to play defense on D-Live and Daniel Gafford. And it's a guy who can get you buckets. And who knows? It's a very unpredictable series. But in the end, at the end of the day, I do think the Dallas Mavericks will take the finals. I do think the Dallas Mavericks do match up well against the Boston Celtics. And honestly, I'm going to look up their record against each other this season, because that does intrigue me. I don't really know how much they actually played this season. I'm assuming they played twice, yeah. The Celtics did win both times. That is interesting information that I'm just learning now. So maybe they are ready. Maybe they can beat the Mavericks. Who knows? But it is hard to beat a team three times in a row. We will see, I guess. Yeah, Josh Green, Luka, Kyrie played good. Tim Hardaway Jr. too. I totally forgot about him. I saw a tweet the other day that Mavericks versus Celtics finals, loser has to re-sign Grant Williams. That made me laugh. These teams both did have Grant Williams and both let him go because he was playing bad. But that is the NBA finals. I'm excited to see how this plays out. In the future episodes, we're looking at maybe a top 10 playoff performers post-finals. We're looking at ranking backcourts maybe. And then we're getting into NBA offseason. We're getting into good stuff. Draft, free agency, all that jazz. We'll see. The Hawks have the number one pick. That's incredible. I might do a series type of thing where I go over every single team in the league and say what I think they should do in the offseason. It might be a little bit difficult to have longer episodes of that. We will see. Let me know what y'all want to listen to or want to hear. I appreciate everybody listening to this episode of the Wildcast, and we'll hope to see you next week. Peace.